Nigerians are expected to seek out the best.
Two words to describe the activity.
Do you ready to form on this
conference? To you, be the first to know. From the north, south, east, west, and around Africa.
Presidential
we break the news.
Women in Nigeria.
Now you can catch all the actions live.
I wish you would.
As the news breaks, we are Core TV News.
Welcome to Core TV Prime Time,
a 24-hour news station.
Thanks for staying with us on the program. The program is Core Digest on Core TV News. And we just want to take a review on the stories making headlines today. And of course, we have the outgoing government has actually submitted the handover notes to the Transition Committee of the All Progressives Congress ahead of the May 29 presidential inauguration. And of course, this happened at a formal as a ceremony that was attended by permanent secretaries of government agencies in Abuja. We have Vice President Namadi Sambo, who charged the incoming administration to study the notes closely. He, however, added that permanent secretaries will be available at any time to clear gray areas if the need arises. Also responding, the chairman of the Transition Committee ahead, Ahmed Joda, actually said he was not disappointed over the level of work done by the outgoing government and promised that the incoming administration would continue with viable projects that they have in store come after May 29.
Agencies of government and the permanent secretaries of each ministry have signed and initialed each page of this report to authenticate and own it. And it is our pleasure to present it to you and pray that it will help guide you and guide the incoming administration. So it is my pleasure for me to formally present to you. This is SDF want me to give all. This is one set of the report. Thank you very much.
There is continuity in government and in governance. Our duty and interest as a committee is to examine these reports carefully and to make recommendations that are not only sensible but practical, especially in the realities that we have to face in the next few months, perhaps few years. In a way, we are beginning from a beginning to chart a new course. And in this, we must try to balance the expectations of the Nigerian people. Indeed, friends of Nigeria from around the world, that what happens between May 29, 2015 and May 29, 2019 will truly be a positive change. We are in one boat, we face one destiny. Let us try to make the best we can.
Well, that was the chairman of the All Progressives Congress Transition Committee, Ahmed Joda, actually expressing his pleasure at what the outgoing government has done with the end over note. And of course, he has said that government is actually a continuum, and so they hope to take over from when the outgoing government has stopped. Mifemi, what story do you have on your plate?
You know, just before we go there, it,
It's also good news that eventually they hand over the
notice here, because you recall that that raised some dust with the APC that shouted for quite a long time that how many days would you give us to go over the notes? And you saw the notes in that video, quite voluminous. I'm wondering who and who will sit down to read all of those. But it's also important to hear Ahmed Joda say that government is a continuum. There should be continuity in governance. And one of the reasons why we have many abandoned projects scattered across the country is because from one administration to the other, each new government comes with its own idea. But then you notice that eventually what we see is a waste of hard-earned taxpayers' money. And you go across the states, you see some estates built, and then you ask, why is that place abandoned? They tell you, oh, it was a former governor that built it, but then the new governor doesn't see anything good in that project. I think that the Buhari administration by now should have identified certain lofty projects started by the Jonathan administration and must have started thinking of ways to continue them. Of course, a lot of fear. You overhear the incumbent president talk about his men are going to be persecuted. There's lots of fear right now as regards how this incoming administration will deal with corruption, especially with the perceived corruption that Nigerians have of the outgoing administration. How do we do this within the confines of the rule of law? Because it's not just bringing people to book. The issue of Buruju Kashiamu now, many people are watching that is the, what do they call them now, the NDLEA. Are they following the procedures of the rule of law? Is there a warrant of arrest? Is there a limit of time that you can hold someone within the house? Because it's not really about how wrong someone is. It's also a question of how right is the process of bringing that person to justice. And I think that the Buhari administration shouldn't be in a haste. Because some people are beginning to say, oh, we need money to run government. Oh, the federal government is in debt. You need to get the money back from the ministers who have stolen the fund. In a hurry, we shouldn't be in a hurry also to now trample on the rule of law in our passion or our zeal to get the money back. So I think put all of this together, it's important also that there has to be a continuity. And in the process of getting justice or fighting corruption, it has to be done within the confines of the rule of law. And I think this is where the judiciary, that arm of government that interprets the law, also has to come forth, with timely judgment. The idea of sitting back at home, going to court, using a decade, at times you just notice that even the prosecuting counsel starts growing cold feet because, I mean, we talked about someone who did something wrong and then you are there 10, 15 years. Not the Buruju Kashiamu case happened in 1994.
Over 20 years now.
Over 20 years now. And then you are wondering, didn't the NDLEA knew that this guy had a case to answer in the U.S. while he was contesting? Why did they have to wait till when the U.S. started painting Nigerian black?
Because the pressure is much
that, a drug baron won elections in Nigeria. Has all of these things been proven? Why did we have to wait? If Buhari didn't win election, will this be a challenge? I mean, these are all things that we must bring together. We mustn't just get excited about the fact that, it looks as if suddenly everybody's waking up and knowing what to do per time. I think that we also have to look beyond what it's been done to consider the intent behind the deeds. And it has to be put in the right perspective.
Yeah, very true. And, what the Vice President actually said is actually a good thing in the right direction. Actually coming out to say that every member of the outgoing administration will be ready to answer questions to clear gray areas, because if you really do not have any skeleton in your cupboard, you should feel free for people to walk up to you and question you on some of the things you actually presented in your handover note. Of course, you presented it, so people should readily be free to ask questions it. And for him to come out to say that, it actually shows that they are ready to play the game right. And the incoming administration would do well to critically look at the notes and investigate the note, not because they want to indict anyone, but of course, see good reasons where they feel they should really ask questions and not just for victimization sake.
You know, I'm going to be honest with you, I'm quite skeptical about this because for every policy, for everything that we've experienced in this part of the country, there's been some level of political coloration. And then at a time whereby the APC has already started talking about what a disastrous time to take over power, what, I think that we have to be careful not to look for someone to blame for the problems.
Yeah.
Because APC saw all of this before they brought us the message of change.
Mm-hmm.
So there is no excuse for the incoming administration at this time.
Mm-hmm.
Even if they can't get the money stolen, they should have an idea of how to generate more funds.
Mm-hmm.
The idea of states not being able to pay salaries is unpardonable. It's a lack of creativity on the part of leadership. Because beyond what you collect as your federal government allocation, there's what they call the internally generated revenue. But you know, we seem to have the easy way out. People go out borrowing to pay salaries. It's an anathema. It's leadership at its peak now. Nigeria is in such a very sensitive time in its history whereby we just don't need men who are pot-bellied politicians.
Mm-hmm.
We need young-minded. They might be old, really, but they have to be upwardly mobile and thinking.
Mm-hmm.
They must come to the table with the ideas. They must be able to make sense with what seemingly is nothing. They must be able to productively engage themselves in the area of leadership. And I think that's what faithfulness is all about,
yeah.
Being able to be productive with somewhat, no matter how little the resources
is.
So
well.
At this very particular time, I am skeptical. I am hopeful that this new administration wouldn't just be busy looking for scapegoats,
mm-hmm. Well,
you know, at the expense of the ordinary Nigerian.
Yeah, pretty
you know,
much
suffering.
In the direction of what the National Publicity Secretary of the People's Democratic Congress, People's Democratic
Party.
Okay.
Now you're finding it hard to understand what PDP is, but
can you imagine?
You definitely
I said the People's Democratic Congress. Okay, that's an enlightenment. But
mm-hmm.
but really, Lisa Meto actually pointed out that the APC actually knew how the fact that Nigeria had a dwindling economy, so they shouldn't come up with the fact that Nigeria has debt, because this debt did not crop up from the last administration. It's actually a backlog of what has been owed over the years, and so it didn't start now. And so if the All Progressive Congress saw the way Nigeria is and the promise that they would pay core members who just left service allowance, they would give free food to students. You know, it's really time for them to play on their promises.
The kids are already
salivating.
Salivating for the free
so
lunch that they
it wouldn't be an excuse that Nigeria is in a lot of debt or because some people mismanaged some funds at some point. That is why you would not play out on your promises. And one very interesting thing is that the national chairman, the chairman of the party, that's John Odigwu Oyegun, said that Nigerians should judge the party with their manifesto.
Mm.
And so if Nigerians would judge you based on the manifesto you presented, because they said they had a template that they wanted to operate on, and because
that's
they had a vision, so it means no excuse whatsoever.
It's also amazing that he came up recently to say that with the myriad of challenges going on right now in the country, that Nigerians shouldn't expect a miracle.
Is that missing his words now?
I wouldn't want to say that, but I think it's also realistic on the part of Nigerians. They say our expectation is high, but what he said is it can't happen overnight. But I think
it would happen.
It will happen. But I also think that the truth is policies can be verbalized overnight.
Mm.
I mean, we don't have to wait 1 year before we know that this direction we are taking is wrong. And then we come out and say, we're not taking this direction again. We now have this new direction. We're taking. I think that they say in the local parlance that it's from Saturday that you get to know, you know, what Sunday is going to be
like.
I think the very first few steps that this new administration will take in office, I'm talking about in the very first few weeks, will determine to a large extent the kind of expectations that Nigerians will have of them.
Mm-hmm.
But if they continue to follow suit with the same corrupt practices, you know, I think that we need a courageous government.
Yeah.
We need a government that can even, you know, bluff the members of his party and say this is the path that we must take, and this is what we must in critical areas like power. You know, for instance, Nigeria prides itself as one of Africa's highest producing, you know, oil producing nation, and then we are the same nation that has a challenge of providing energy to the people in the area of oil and electricity. It's an anathema. It's not pardonable. And I think that we have to put the blame on the shoulders of the leadership. We keep talking about cabals. We keep talking about remove subsidy. There are some people. I mean, we need a leadership that can sacrifice even his own life and say no to. We had a guest earlier, I think it was last week, and he was talking about the owners of Nigeria.
Of Nigeria,
we need a leader that can call the bluff of these so-called owners and let them know that Nigeria really doesn't belong to you.
Mm-hmm.
It belongs to the over 160 million Nigerians who live within the borders.
And the thing is that they're just the minority of the population.
They are just a minority. And until we put them to jail, I mean, and then if they have stolen money, I think that Buhari just has to be courageous.
Mm-hmm.
And the good thing also is that he's well over 70.
Mm-hmm.
And then at this stage of his life, it's the expectation is that it's not, you probably don't have so much dreams of building castles.
Mm-hmm.
It's about time where you want to build a legacy.
Mm-hmm.
Because what should be a priority for him is what would I leave for the successive generation. And I think that that will also inform, you know, him of doing great things.
Well, for me, I think for this new administration, creativity should actually come to place. Because with the outgoing government, some of them are expressing fear that how can they cope with the way the economy is.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, they would be, the incoming governments would not be successful if they go on with tradition.
Mm-hmm.
If they go on with, oh, this is how it's supposed to be, let's do it this way. Because you can't keep doing the same thing over the years and get a new result. So
mm-hmm.
if you want to get a new result and make things happen miraculously, then you should begin to do something that you bring out of the box. So creativity at this time is very key. If they would be able to bring to bear all of the promises, the promise that lots of Nigerians during the electioneering campaign.
All right, let's take a trip down to Ekiti State. For a while now, it's been some sort of battle between the 16 APC lawmakers who were impeached by a few number at the State House of Assembly. But perhaps the good news for Ekiti people would also be that members of the Ekiti State Executive, as well as this aggrieved APC lawmakers, Adewale Omiri, met somewhere in Akure. It was close to about a four-hour meeting. Some papers are reporting to be a deadlock meeting. Fayose, alongside the Speaker of the 19 APC lawmakers in-house in the House of Assembly, Adewale Omiri, says that the meeting was to find a political solution to the crisis rocking the two arms of government. Among the attendees from the APC is the Deputy Speaker of the G19, Tunde Oreshalade, and the Majority Leader of the APC group, Churchill Adedipe, as well as Bumi Oriyowo, representing the Idose constituency. The outcome of the meeting, however, cannot be quite ascertained at this moment. But we have a few pictures to show you.
Who are the people that met?
Well, the executive and the legislature. And we have met in the overall interest of our state, believing that we'll be able to find solution to the problems.
That is exactly what you have done. That what the governor said is exactly what you have done. Thank you.
Right, so we still cannot tell what the real position is. The state governor is saying that they have taken a step now for the overall interest of the Ekiti people. Adewale Omiri also subscribes to the position of the state governor. But if you ask me, Tayo, there are just few days to hand over.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that probably that's why the 19 APC lawmakers are now thinking dialogue, because there's pretty little they can hold on to, given the fact that the just concluded State House of Assembly election in Ekiti State got the APs, I mean the PDP, sweeping
mm-hmm.
probably all the seats.
Yeah, well, very good thinking, because of course peace is actually the main thing they should actually work with, and considering the crisis that has been rocking Ekiti, so not taking onto the part of dialogue would be a suicidal attempt, because it would just complicates the problem of the Ekiti people. And I think this discussion is a very good thing, and let's see what would be bettered out of this discussion.
Mm.
And let's hope that Ekiti would have its peace restored in the shortest possible time.
All right, the good news for Nigerians yesterday would be that the oil marketers finally called off their strike. As at yesterday in the morning, we were told that in 6 hours the commodity will be loading. And then, given the kind of challenges that Nigerians have faced in the past few
mm-hmm.
days, our focus on the show today will be to find out where is the fuel. But before then, let's just quickly show you what it was like yesterday, the days preceding yesterday, the challenges that Nigerians faced, and really what is... Okay, let's start with the scarcity resolution. Really, all the parties involved in that issues that led to the nationwide food scarcity thankfully reached an agreement at a meeting that was brokered by the Senate. I think now that senators could not get fuel, they quickly had to do something about it. Chairman, Senate Committee on Petroleum Downstream, Magnus Abbey, disclosed this after a closed-door meeting on the sidelines of an investigative hearing on the nationwide fuel crisis. He noted that following the resolution, oil marketers and tanker drivers would begin to lift fuel at depots within 6 hours of agreement. That was about, that should be about 7:30 yesterday night.
With the unions within the NNPC, that also resulted in a solution to the problems of the strike in the NNPC just in the course of our meeting right now. So as we speak now, we have clear information that the Nupeng and Pengasin strike has been called off following the intervention of the GMD and this committee.
Of course, we have really discussed. I'm sure that from today, it is also known that we are not fraudulent and that the words like we don't trust should be removed from the minds of everybody.
We're able to unravel so many aspects, from logistics to finance to, you know, very many other parts of the problem that hopefully will now be resolved as we move forward. In our own case, we endorse the summary you made, and we'll move forward on that to issue a letter to Moman and Dapman, just noting that there's a committee working, and the outcome of that will be documented, and government is continuous. So whatever comes out will be taken up as we move along in the next government.
Stakeholders in the meeting yesterday, and I believe the impression of many Nigerians, aftermath of the first scarcity was the fact that, well, the outgoing administration had just a few days to spend in office, and this is probably why they're not showing much interest. But I think it's good news that we'll also see stakeholders, even with the outgoing administration, talking about these issues and preferring way forward. I think it's also not that quite good on the part of the followership to assume in a hurry what the position of leadership is. They say uneasy lies ahead, that wears the crown. And if you're not there, you probably do not know what the challenges feel like. Because at some point, you know, we had a guest yesterday who was talking about the responsibility of the government. I was also asking him that probably this is a sabotage. If Capital Oil, or what was the name of that
filling station, Oil,
could sell at 87 naira, it meant that the reason why all the marketers were not sending, selling, was to make a point or to send a particular message. And I think that oftentimes we've had this challenge between government and unions, you know, reaching a deadlock where, you know, you just notice that members of the union at some point just feel like, oh, you've pushed us to the wall, and now we have to turn back again. So I still personally have challenges with medical doctors going on strike on that front. I think there should be a more creative way of solving our problems rather than pushing it to an extent whereby it becomes a national embarrassment, becomes, you know, a means of suffering for the people before we start taking steps.
Yeah, very true. And, you know, with what happened yesterday, it goes to show that the solution could actually come to play. Now, the question really is, should we really get to a brick wall before we come up with resolution? Because, of course, according to some of these markets, as I said, they've held meetings that didn't really yield any positive thing. But miraculously, yesterday, a meeting held, and they said marketers should start giving up in 6 hours.
I'm wondering what the promises were, and then what...
or what did they say differently from what they have been discussing since? Well, you know these things, we just are really glad that at least something positive is being done, and such a tone should be maintained, because the country should not get to a point of crippling before people rise to the challenge. The challenge is really, and yesterday we actually brought to you what's really happened, how the fuel scarcity brought a lot of activities to crippling level in Lagos State, and we just want to show you what really happened in the state capital in Abuja, how the fuel crisis made a lot of events kind of crippling in
and
the state
course,
capital.
The reaction of
and
Nigerians.
Of course, reaction of Nigerians.
Very touching stories
capital.
Of people telling you what it feels like, how much they earn,
mm-hmm.
and then how much is expected of them to pay for transportation.
Exactly.
We'll be back with you after this.
These are some fuel stations in the Federal Capital Territory. And like many others, they are not dispensing product of any kind. But this one in Highbrow Mitama District is functional. On inquiry, Core TV News found out that only a few privileged individuals are being serviced. But even in their present state, motorists are still on queue to get a product that is seemingly not available. Some say they have been at filling stations for about 3 days, all to no avail. Now they are asking government to give reasons for their predicaments.
Today night they sell in there between 10 and 11, they sell fuel. They sell fuel. To some people, we beg them to tell them when petrol, they say no. I'm stranded here because I can't go back. I don't have fuel in my car to go back. I better just leave the car here.
On Saturday, I came here again. On Saturday, I parked my car here, and to my greatest surprise, they did not sell fuel. Saturday, Sunday, I was here. Even to up to today, Monday, I'm still here waiting to buy fuel. I'm here with my car. If I go, I'll just go and take my bath and come back just to get fuel. I don't know what is going on in the country. If it's the subsidy, they should remove it so that we will rest.
This man says he had to rely on public transportation to get to the office, but is angered by the hike in fare.
Very unbearable over the weekend, not having to be able to drive your car. As you can see, I was just trekking down now, parking my car at home. This is my car key. I couldn't drive it. I had to take a public transport down here, which was very, very exorbitant, if I could put it that way. So many people are stranded. They are stranded. Not many people could afford to even find their way to their destination. Well, from there, like, from Utako to this place, now I have to pay like 300.
In the light of all this, this other man can only see a bleakness ahead and is wondering how May 29 would play out.
We are meant to be celebrating Democracy Day. We are meant to be celebrating 29th of this month. But do you expect me to come out and celebrate? To celebrate what? When I don't have food on my table, when there's no light in my house, when I don't have water. This morning, as early as 5 a.m., go to the road and see. Try it yourself tomorrow morning. Go and see what is happening on the road. As at 4:35 a.m., you see masses on the road. Somebody that is earning 20,000 naira salary. You spend 300 naira to and fro, 600 naira. How much is your salary? It's heartbreaking. It is painful. And like I said, it is devastating. Until the country will know what to do and solve this problem once and for all. Otherwise, I repeat, we are heading to God knows where.
As the fuel situation in the country gets worse and Nigerians recount their travail, they can only hope that respite comes soon. From the streets of Abuja, Basi Aye, Core TV News. Well, for residents in Abuja, they didn't really have it easy. And of course, that was what they experienced yesterday, being Monday. And with the resolution that happened yesterday, we're really hoping that the story would have changed by now.
I'm more particularly concerned about the impact that this would have on the average Nigerian, the perception of the government, the perception of being a Nigerian in and of itself, because you recall when one of them said in that report, we're counting down to an inauguration day, May 29, supposed to be a national day. Of course, there's going to be a public holiday, and then there will be dignitaries coming from outside the country. But then you hear someone say, what's there to celebrate? What's there to go out for when I cannot cater for myself, when I can't get food, when I can't get water, when I can, you know, have access to basic amenities? It also, I think what it does overall, you know, is that it creates some sort of distance between the governed and the governor, if I can put it that way. You begin to see that distance between Nigerians and the government, and then you begin to wonder how we can actually move forward if there is no cooperation. I've been in public vehicles and I've heard people say things like, I've never gained anything from this government. I paid my school fees, I pay for power, I fuel my generator, I send my children to school. And I think this is going to be a great challenge for the incoming administration to keep bridging that gap mm-hmm. between Nigerians and their government. Because until we have that populace that believe in the Nigerian leadership, we're not going to get the kind of support that mm-hmm. is needed at the helms of affair, because they need to be motivated. They need to be believed. We need Nigerians who can be proud to say, oh, I am Nigerian. We need well-educated Nigerians, you know, except for not the continuous brain drain that we have, where mm-hmm. people will be well-taught and well-schooled, and then they take all the skills outside the country. We need that gap to be bridged, and I think that's the next level required to give birth to that Nigeria of our dreams.
Yeah, well, another thing that I quite agree with is what the national chairman of NUPENG said, Achese Igwe. He said that Nigeria cannot overcome the recurring problem of fuel scarcity if the right things are not being put in place. And of course, he mentioned the fact that our refineries really have to be working.
That's right.
The fact that we should look at importation as our only means of getting this product, because of course we produce it, so why should we rely so much on importation? Then he also suggested that subsidy should be entirely removed. That's otherwise, right. We would keep having this problem. It could take another 10 years or 5 years for us to come back to the same problem. So I think the thing is looking at the problem holistically and looking at a way to find a lasting solution to it, not just Nigerians suffer a little, there's a water of relief, then we go back to suffering, and it keeps going back and forth. And a question a lot of Nigerians are asking is, do we really deserve this suffering, this terrible treatment we always find ourselves? And like the guest said, that Nigerians have grown thick skins, that when we suffer for a while, we tend to forget, and we say, okay, let's move ahead with life. Well, really, it shouldn't be like that.
And it also further buttresses the need for us to start considering alternative sources of energy, not only sources of energy, alternative sources of income. You know, I was hearing one of the stakeholders in the southern region of Nigeria talking about people in the Niger Delta calling for 100% resource control of that particular resource they call the oil. So the reason why we all talk about oil is because that seems to be the only thing our eyes are open to. There are other sources of energy. There is solar power, you know, there's wind, there's many things that we can also capitalize on. Not to talk about the agricultural sector, that we have the land, we have our land, for instance, quite amazing, has the capacity to grow almost anything, you know, across the world. That's the peculiarity of what we have in this country. And I think until we start looking beyond the oil money, of course, the dwindling global oil price should also show open our eyes to the reality.
And prepare us ahead.
That this is not going to be there forever. Mm-hmm. The countries we sell oil to are also discovering oil, and they're also improving on alternative sources of energy. And I think that these times call for critical thinking on the part of leadership. And it starts with us appointing people who are there, who can think, not just people's, not just settling them.
Or ceremonial, you know,
or ceremonial appointments.
We don't really need that at this time.
We've gone way past that. We are in a season whereby we need to brainstorm.
Experts in that particular
expertise.
Thing.
You know, we need to now think of how do we channel a new course for this great nation? Mm-hmm. How do we ensure that we put the right people in the right places? And then rebuild a nation that is crumbling in our very eyes, because people have started talking about, if we get the commodity in our locality, then we should be in charge of that commodity. The only reason why you'll be talking about it is because that's the only commodity you have in mind. What happens to gold? What happens to coal? What happens to many other valuable mineral resources that are embedded in this land? All we need is just a paradigm shift in our thinking and ensure that a lot is done to bring all of this together. We'll take a short break here. When we come back on the show, we'll find out where the fuel really is, especially now the oil marketers have called off the strike. The expectations are high. We saw almost an instant effect on the streets of Lagos where it looks as if the tide is changing. We don't know where the fares are going to get back to normal really, but we are hopeful that the fuel will soon be available. We'll be calling, talking with our correspondents scattered across the country and find out what the situation is really. Stick around, don't go away.
Every day, every hour, and every minute, news break in Nigeria. Things happen so fast, it's most times difficult to track and comprehend them. But that's what we do right here on Digi360. 2015, would you want to come back again?
It's like asking Jesus Christ if he knew he was going to die, will you come? Will you want to come back as the savior of the world again?
We do not just help you track the stories, we break them down. Explore all the angles, analyze the issues so that you can fully comprehend the stories and use them to make the right decisions.
Women share the most amazing thoughts on national issues and they do it passionately.
For most men that are educated, that are exposed, would see nothing to it.
The population and the level of poverty made me cry. No infrastructural development whatsoever. And you tell me Lagos is working?
That was an accident. And it was a one-off thing. Other than that, there has never been any situation in Nigeria where a Nigerian attacked anybody just because of where they came from.
Sharing the adorable word of women in politics every week, only on Core TV News.
As news breaks, people don't let events pass without giving their comment or reactions.
When the problem arises in society, these are the people that should be consulted.
To cleanse the corruption in society, we are not to provide information for good life and also security of life and property in this country.
The academic society have the loudest voice on this platform.
Whether you call it a sovereign national conference or a national conference, it is about the people of Nigeria.
Should be a change in power.
In any way they can do it.
I think there's a script already.
Every Tuesday at 8:45 p.m. on this station. From the Ivory Tower, a must watch for the learning minds.
Every day of the week will bring to you divergent views on news making the headline.
These people who commit crime are being rewarded with national honors, with national appointments. Then where are we going in this country?
It's not about who, whether it was Jonathan or whether you are going to have a Buhari. It's the kind of political structure we run.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
We are talking about a Buhari who at 41 became head of state. The man did not exhibit the attribute of somebody that is strong intellectually.
So comrade, you're saying if you become governor, you're going to bring back Okada?
Of course.
You will bring back the market women from the streets?
Excuse me, don't put words in my mouth.
On Core Digest, we bring all of this to the court of public opinion with you are the judge.